remember, we've got a big new audience here. We're on SiriusXM. So if you would run through the various types of civilizations that I know you you measure, or it's a way of measuring, I guess. Again, we are, before we even begin, we remain, I take it, a type zero.
That's right. We physicists like to measure everything in terms of energy. That's how we quantify things, including civilizations in outer space. So if you look at outer space, there must be three types of civilizations, type one, type two, type three, depending upon energy output. Eventually, a civilization becomes planetary. They control the oceans. They mine they can mine the earth. They can mine the oceans. They control the weather. So they control all planetary energy like volcanoes and earthquakes. That's type one. Type two is they've exhausted the power of a planet and they start to mobilize the power of a star. They play with stars like Star Trek. The Federation of Planets would be a very typical type two civilization where they've colonized just a few star systems. Then eventually you exhaust the power of a star and you go to the galaxy. That's type three, where you roam the galactic space lanes like the Empire of Empire Strikes Back. So we have planets, stars, and galaxies. But recently I was speaking in London and a little kid comes up to me and he says, "Professor, you're wrong. There's got to be type four." And I said, "Well, you're crazy. There's no such thing as type four. There are only planets, stars, and galaxies." And he said, "No, there's type four, the power of the continuum." And then I realized, yeah, there is something beyond galactic power, and that's dark energy. And that's the continuum. That's the power of the Q. And I realized, oh, my God, there really is an extragalactic source of energy out there, dark energy, which actually makes up about 73% of the universe's energy.
So and dark matter?
Yeah, dark matter is in there. And now on this scale, what are we on this scale? We are type zero. We get our energy from dead plants, oil and coal, right?
But we do deserve to call ourselves a civilization, yes?
Yes, we are type zero. And we're about 100 years from being type one. If you just get a calculator and calculate the energy output of the Earth, we're about a zero in about 100 years will be type one. So we are now making the historic transition to type one. So what is the internet? The internet is a type one telephone system. We're privileged to be alive to see the birth of a beginning of a type one technology called the internet. The language that these people will speak, well, today, the two dominant languages of the internet are English and Mandarin. So we are already beginning to see a type one language. Soccer and the Olympics is beginning of a type 1 sports. The European Union, NAFTA, we see the beginning of a type 1 economy.
Quick question. Do you think that in 100 years, English will still be part of a type 1 civilization?
Probably be the dominant language. Everywhere I go around the world, people speak English to each other. I could go to Vietnam and see Chinese, Vietnamese, and Laotian physicists, and they all speak English to each other because there's no common language in Asia other than English. And the same thing in Europe. You can go to a conference in Europe among scientists, and they all speak English. Business, finance, arts, everyone speaks English.
Okay, that's comforting. We'll be here, or at least our language will.
That's right. And the question is whether or not we're going to be here. That's the big question, Mark.
Actually, you know, in the old days when I interviewed you about this, I asked you about the odds of either A, being destroyed as a type zero, or B, making it to type one and, you know, popping the corks on champagne. But I don't know. I've got this feeling that you probably haven't changed your mind. What are the odds that we make it successfully to type one without destroying ourselves?
Well, this is the most historic transition in the history of our civilization, the transition from type zero to type one. And it's not guaranteed that we're going to make it because we have global warming, nuclear proliferation, the spread of biogerms. We have threats we create ourselves. And so it's not clear. However, I'd say 50-50 now. I'm a little bit more optimistic than I was when I first talked to you.
I should say. That's a big change.
Yeah,
that,
I think
that makes
so.
Me feel better. I feel a lot better now.
Yeah, no, I think 50-50 that, you know, we have a fighting chance that, that we'll make it to type 1.
Okay, look, it wasn't that long ago that we spoke. Now, between then and now, what's encouraged you?
Well, you know, the economy collapsed.
It did.
And we hit rock bottom. But
it
hey,
did.
You know, we're still here, right?
Appear to be.
Yeah. And, you know, we were in denial about so many of these problems back then. But now, you know, they dominate the headlines, you know, global warming and, you know, nuclear proliferation, stuff like that. People are beginning to get aware of some of these things. And so I think that that's going to be good. And, you know, democracy is spreading because of the Internet. Look at Arab Spring and look at the spread of democracy because of the Internet. And democracies do not war with other democracies. You know, think of every war that you've learned since you were in grade school. And they've always been between kings, queens, emperors, and dictators, but never between two democracies. And so as the Internet spreads democracies, democracies don't war with other democracies. And so I think we will have wars in the future, but they're going to be less wars, less ferocious, and less common as the spread of democracy takes hold. The big loser in all this, I think, are dictatorships. Dictatorships thrive on the ignorance of their own people. And I think, you know, to be a dictator is to be an endangered species.
I would have to agree. I mean, recent history certainly proves that, right? So,
yeah,
yes.
That's what the glimmer of hope. I'm not quite as pessimistic as I was before. I see the spread of democracy. People are becoming more aware of these problems. And democracies debate these problems. And they confront them. And they don't war with each other.
That's optimism, all right. By the way, what about the little trips that we've had along the way? I mean, you know, big earthquakes, nuclear reactors going bonkers.
Yeah, well, it's not clear that we are going to make it. I mean, look at Fukushima, right? That's
yes.
a disaster that no one predicted. Three simultaneous meltdowns. You realize that the core at the Fukushima liquefied? We've never seen liquefaction of a nuclear reactor core before.
Actually, I think it was three of them, right?
Three of them, right. Three liquefactions of molten uranium. And you realize that we still have not controlled it. They could spiral out of control any day. A small little earthquake, and the reactor accident starts up all over again.
Professor, hold tight right there.